Welcome to the 15th, I thought I said 50th, 15th meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2023. And I note that Ben McPherson sends his apologies this morning. So firstly, I would like to welcome Ivan McKee, who is joining us for the first time this morning as a substitute member of the committee. And our first item of business is to ask, invite Ivan McKee to declare any relevant interests.
No relevant interests.
Thank you very much. Just your microphones were doing a bit of jiggery pokery there. Okay, our second item on our agenda today is an evidence session on university and colleges funding in the 2023-24 budget. And can I welcome the Minister for Higher and Further Education, the Minister for Veterans, who is joining us for the first time since being appointed, albeit not the first time he's been in this room. So welcome, Mr. Day. And alongside the Minister is Cameron Durrani, who is Head of Funding and Sponsorship Unit, Directorate for Lifelong Learning and Skills in the Scottish Government. Good morning. And I note that the Minister has indicated he does not wish to make an opening statement, so we will move straight to questions. Minister, where are the new pressures that have led to the £46 million planned uplift for further and higher education being identified as a necessary saving? And what proportion of that money is now going to be needed to settle the teachers' pay discussion? And are there any other areas in which that £46 million is now being spent?
Well, you've hit the nail on the head, Convener. It is principally the teachers' pay settlement. You'll recall that the former Education Secretary at this committee in February had indicated that the monies linked to the teacher pay settlement would have to come from within the education budget, and that is principally what's at play here. There are always pressures on portfolio budgets at a variety of times, but that's the principal one that has led to us taking this regrettable decision.
Do you feel comfortable that you've almost pitted teachers and colleges and universities against each other? Because you're saying, sorry, colleges and universities, you can't have this, and you're not as important as teachers, perhaps.
Well, I don't think we've set up. I don't think our language around that has been of that nature. I think we've just tried to be open and transparent about what has led to this. And, you know, it is regrettable that we are not in a position to provide that additional money that we had indicated we would to colleges and universities. That's what we wanted to do. But this is the reality that we're operating in, and we have to deal with the situation as it exists.
Mr. Kerr, you've indicated you've got a brief supplementary here.
What's the total cost of the teachers' pay settlement for 23-24?
Cameron, do you want to?
It's about £188 million, and that covers 21-22 to 23-24, so it's...
No, just 23-24. Well, yeah, the money for 23-24 that's impacted by the £46 million.
So that's £89 million, but the pressure also covers previous year's amount.
So it is 188 then?
It's 188. On 23-24, the pressure was 188.
So my question to the Minister is... Where's the rest coming from?
Well, as the Cabinet Secretary, then Cabinet Secretary, indicated at the time, that would have to be worked through the education budget as a whole, and that's what's happening.
But that's a lot of money, Minister. Where is it actually coming from?
It is indeed a lot of money, Mr. Kerr, and you'll recall that all parties called for efforts to get that dispute settled. That's what we did. It was welcomed, and you'll appreciate that. In the context of the education budget, the current education secretary is having to make some tough decisions.
But, Minister, you would also expect that, as the committee responsible for education scrutiny in this parliament, we want to know where the other budgets are impacted. We want to know where the rest of this money is coming from in detail. And we're not getting that information today. Mm-hmm. Can you write to us and give us a complete breakdown of all the different budgets, where this money is coming from?
That remains a work in progress, but we'll be happy to write to the committee with as much detail as we can provide.
Thank you. The colleges described the cuts as completely inexplicable, College of Scotland rather, at a time when colleges are already cash-strapped, and University Scotland said the cut will compromise our capacity to contribute to the nation's recovery. So what's the Minister's response to those statements?
I think it is explainable. I think we've explained why it's had to be necessary. But I entirely recognise the disappointment and concern that has been expressed both by the colleges and the universities over the impact of this. The Cabinet Secretary and myself met with College of Scotland principals and chairs last week. We also met with the College of Scotland reps the same day. And we've met with University of Scotland. So we've had some detailed discussions about this. They've expressed their concerns. But I understand those concerns entirely. What I would say is that, particularly in the context of colleges, we're already attempting to move on from this jointly and to determine how we can support the colleges into a more sustainable position going forward. We are having and will have some more conversations with the universities.
I know my colleague will come on to questions around that support later on. But in terms of the timing of the announcement, Minister, why were colleges and universities not informed sooner? It all seemed quite...
Well, actually, they were informed as soon as it was practical to do that. Now, the way the SFC process works, the final allocations are normally advised at the end of May. We wanted to do it as soon as we possibly could, and it was announced at the beginning of May. None of this is easy. We recognise the problems it caused, but we did try to make them aware of the situation as quickly as we could.
Okay. Understandably, it did come as a surprise and as a shock to them.
I recognise that.
Can I move to questions now from Bill Kidd, please?
Yep. Thanks very much, Convener. Thank you, Minister. Right, you've slightly preempted what I was going to ask, but I've got a couple of questions. I'll put them together and see what we can get back. So you say you've had meetings with FE and HE sectors following the announcement, and two things out of that. One, what particular concerns were raised, and are you aware of specific colleges and universities now needing financial assistance as a result of the decision?
Okay, I'm not aware of any colleges or universities who are requiring specific assistance. I think it's important to recognise that these monies were for transition purposes. They were not owing to the core teaching funding settlement. I'm reluctant to get into some of the specifics about what we discussed with the colleges and universities out of courtesy to them. But what I would say, Mr. Kidd, is there is a joint recognition of some of the challenges they face, and particularly in the case of the colleges, a commitment to work together to try and find... the committee in its report talked about additional flexibilities that colleges might want. So there are conversations in that space going on. I'm sure the committee may wish to explore this further. I would describe the discussions with the colleges, notwithstanding the understandable upset they had, as very constructive, and I'm confident we can move forward from here and find a positive way forward. Our conversations with University of Scotland have been more initial, but the Cabinet Secretary and I intend to build on those by engaging directly with the principals and chairs, hopefully in a single gathering.
Okay, thank you for that. Just to let you know that we have been informed in this instance by Unison, but also by some people who attend or work in City of Glasgow College, in terms of a loss of jobs, basically. Jobs go in compulsory redundancies, and a lack of capability to agree voluntary severance payments. Now, one of the things about that is that people are in danger of losing their jobs, and in fact they've been told they're going to lose their jobs, and this was actually even on the cards before the cut in money. So how have you, I mean, you haven't heard anything about that then? I think that you will be hearing about it fairly soon, actually.
I'm entirely aware of the situation at City Glasgow College, both from the trade union's perspective and from the principal. I think we need to be clear here that the actions taken by City of Glasgow College are not linked to the £26 million. That was for transition purposes. That was being discussed with the Scottish Funding Council. But I recognise that a flat cash settlement for colleges creates challenges. And City of Glasgow, and you will appreciate that colleges are standalone institutions. They will react to situations in an individual way. I recognise that the situation there is particularly difficult at the moment. I will be meeting the unions in due course. But it's not, very clearly, this is not linked to the £26 million. It's linked to the wider issues in the college sector.
I can understand that's definitely the case. But just that obviously that this £26 million loss will actually impact further on that, you know, so that's basically what, I presume so. But that's basically the worry. But you say you're going to be meeting up with the unions anyway, aren't you?
Yeah, perhaps it would be useful, convener, if I explained what the additional money was there to support what was termed strategic change. And there were conversations taking place between the SFC, I think initial conversations, and both sectors. And some of the areas that were being considered including supporting institutional transformation planning, helping institutions collaborate to deliver their provision, a national college estates assessment, and developing a student records system. Those were some of the things that were under discussion. That's what the money was being directed to do. It wasn't simply about providing extra funds for the sake of providing extra funds. There was a specific purpose behind it.
Right. And you are going to be meeting the Unison and the other unions? I
think I'm meeting Unite very shortly. I met EIS FIWA last week. So that's all in the pipeline.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you.
There's a lot of overlap with a lot of the questions. I've got a very brief supplementary on this from Pam, I believe, before we go. Pam Duncan Clancy, sorry, before we go to Bob Dorris.
Thank you, convener, and I will be brief because I'll get an opportunity, I think, to ask further questions in this particular area. But are you content that there could be 100 jobs lost? And I take the point about it's not as a direct result of the £26 million, but the letter we have from the college says that it is as a result of the sector's budget cuts over a number of years. So I don't think it's fair to the people who are losing their jobs to just say, oh, it's not because of the £26 million.
I think I was making stating a fact. It isn't about the £26 million. No, I'm not comfortable that people are facing the prospect of losing their jobs. Not comfortable at all, but with respect, Ms. Duncan Glancy, we've already heard the challenges, the budgetary challenges that are faced here. And if the committee or anyone else wants to say, as they're entitled to, there should be more money put into colleges, you need to tell us from where it comes. Because this was part of the issue around the teachers' pay settlement. Everybody wanted the then Education Secretary, and understandably so, to settle that dispute. She was very clear that if that happened, the money would have to come from somewhere else. And regrettably, we don't have an endless pot of money here. And a flat cash settlement was as good as could be achieved, given the budget pressures that the government's facing. And as I say, I keep saying it, I regret the consequences for the colleges there and for staff.
Bob Dorris now, please.
Thank you, convener. I want to ask a little bit more about the £26 million, Minister. I mean, we were all pretty shocked when that was taken off the table. I was involved in representations trying to get government with your predecessor to signal that £26 million will be embedded into the core settlement. Because my understanding, convener, is if it was embedded into the core settlement, we'd be looking at less redundancies, hopefully all voluntary severance, and less course mergers and amalgamations, because colleges are, as we speak, finishing 5-year forward plans. Where if that £26 million was embedded each and every year, we'd have more lecturers, more associated staff, and more courses. And they were really, really disappointed. So would you acknowledge that whilst 1 year £26 million may not impact on courses and lecturers and numbers, but had it been embedded, it absolutely would have impacted?
£26 million was for 23-24 only. That was what was on the table. So the other thing I should say here is that the actual resource budget afforded colleges since 2012-2013 has increased by over £168 million in cash terms. Now, I recognise the pressures that colleges will have faced over that period, but it has increased. Now, so has demand. Inflation is putting pressure on everything else that we know about. But that's why the exercise we're currently engaged on with the colleges is so important, to look at how we make them more sustainable going forward. And I give you the assurance that that is what's driving the discussions.
I don't just want to move on from that £26 million, Minister. I get it was 1 year, but the ongoing discussions that I thought were taking place was if we could get some comfort to indicate that the government would be keen to see that baselined into future settlements, that colleges would have changed those five-year plans accordingly, and that just hasn't happened. So my question would be, should Barnett consequentials appear for your portfolio, would those be directed at colleges, given they are the big losers right now under the reprovisioning of monies to pay for pay deals for schools?
If Barnett consequentials, as you put it, or appeared, or if the financial situation improved, then I would say that colleges would be a priority for us, because moving forward, colleges will be at the very heart of what we're going to be doing. So I entirely recognise the challenges that colleges are presented with beyond the 26 million. And from my perspective, they would be a priority if and when an opportunity arose to better support them.
And if that opportunity arose, I think we'd be looking for that to be recurring funds embedded into their core settlement, rather than this whole this whole situation we had about, is it recurring, is it non-recurring, is it transitional, is it embedded core funding, and the confusion, because I know there was confusion between the Scottish Funding Council and college principals in relation to exactly what they could use that for.
Well, Mr Dorris, I can't sit here today and say there will be Barnett consequentials, or there will be more money available, let alone say that if such became available, it could be recurring for the next 2, 3, 4, 5 years. It's impossible to say that. What I would say to you is that from our perspective, contrary to how they may be feeling right now, given what's happened, colleges are very much at the heart of what we plan for the coming years. And where it's at all possible, we will look to support them through the budget to that end.
Have you made the case to government colleagues for money to be transferred from other portfolios into the education portfolio?
Mr Dorris, I think you and others are well aware that the financial challenges that are faced by the education portfolio are replicated across government. The Scottish Government's budget, as a consequence of issues out with our control, suffered a significant hit. The public finances faced probably the biggest challenge since devolution. So it's not a case that we could ask other portfolios to transfer money across to education. I wish it was. There are challenges for all areas of government, and we have to get through this the best way we can.
No further questions on this, but when I meet AIS Fila at City of Glasgow College in a week or so's time, they're going to be asking me these questions, so I'm sure you'll understand why I'm asking you these questions.
Thank you, Mr Dorris. I suppose in terms of when you are in government, it's all about choices, Minister, and I'm sure the choices across various portfolios that are up to the decisions that your government has made. Mr Kerr, I'd like to go to some supplementaries on here as well.
So, personally, I mean, the Minister is someone who I actually do respect. He sat beside me in this committee just a few weeks ago. We've heard him ask questions of ministers that have come before us before. We've heard him talk about his passion for this. So I don't doubt his personal commitment. But it is a bit rich to keep going on as a minister and saying to us as members, well, tell us where we can save the money and we'll spend it. We don't know where the money can be saved, just like we don't know where the rest of the money is going to come from to pay the teacher settlement. Now, if you want a number of us to come and sit down and go through all your budgets with you, I'm up for that. But I think ministers should stop pretending that somehow we have the sight of things, the vision that you've got. So my question is very simply this. The colleges said, and I know you agree with this, colleges said,
in their submission. Colleges are needed more than now than now than ever to mitigate poverty in communities across the country, provide life-changing opportunities for people and create the future workforce which will tackle the climate emergency. And I know that we all agree with that. But look at the record of the SNP in government for the last 16 years. In recent answers you gave to colleagues in parliamentary questions, it transpires that the number of students, the number of people studying in our colleges in the 16 years of this SNP government has gone down 33%. And the cost of funding every place has gone down, in real terms, 10%. These are the answers that you gave to parliamentary colleagues. This is a hatchet job on the college sector. How can the college sector do the job that we all know it needs to do when it's being... It's the victim of a government hatchet job over 16 years.
So, Mr. Kerr, as usual, there's lots of hyperbole and all that.
Facts! These are the things
Let's deal in facts. There were 322,332 enrolments at Scottish colleges in 21-22, an increase of 16% since 1920. Colleges delivered 129,500. 59 FTEs, an increase of 0.5% since 2021. Student support, very substantial amount of money is put into colleges, 135 million is maintained because of the very issues that you're talking about, the poverty challenges. And we've directed a lot of that to students from the poorer areas. But my point with regard to funding...
record and it's gone from 354,000 to 236,000, which is a 33% reduction. That's a hatchet job on the capacity of the college sector.
And since 2012-2013, the college sector budget has increased by 168 million.
You came into government.
Well, Mr. Kerr, but I want to answer the central point. It is not a case of the government, myself, saying... passing the buck here. But the point I would make is this committee and much of the very fine work it's done, part of that was the attainment funding. So we did a report on that. And the additional monies that were provided to tackle those issues were very much welcomed by the committee, by the wider parliament. That money has to come from somewhere.
You're resorting to answer A again.
Mr. Kerr, it's a fact. And if we... collectively as a parliament welcome that. We have to recognise if we spend money in that area, there won't be money for something else. That is the reality of government. And I'm afraid we can't simply sit and go, more money for this, more money for that, whether it be in education or anything, without there being consequences. And unfortunately, these are the consequences.
Open the books then.
Okay,
can I invite us in and we'll sit down.
Thank you, Mr. Kerr. Can we move now to questions from Ivan McKee, please?
Thanks very much, Convener. Just a brief supplementary, Minister, before I move on to the substance of my questions. Just a point of clarification. The £26 million, you're indicating that was would have been a one-off payment to the colleges just for this year. That's now being used, as you indicated, to fund or help fund part of the teachers' pay settlement. The teachers' pay settlement clearly isn't a one-off payment because it needs to be funded on an ongoing basis.
So there is a future pressure there, absolutely.
Yeah. There isn't an answer to that yet. That's a future issue. Just to be clear on that. Okay. Obviously, the situation with colleges, as other members have indicated, is very significant by the college sector. And I met myself at Glasgow Kelvin College earlier this week to talk about this and other matters, and like other members, getting significant correspondence on this. One of the issues that they raised with me, amongst many, was... the journey of that money, if you like, from Scottish Government down to the colleges on the front line themselves. And I just wanted to unpick a wee bit of that to help understand some of the numbers behind that. So clearly the money moves from Scottish Government to SFC. There's obviously, in the case of Glasgow, the Glasgow Regional College Board as well. So starting off with the Scottish Government, if you look at Economy Directorate, for 23-24, there's a £49 million budget in there. Now, I know that Scottish Government total operating cost budgets are generally significantly overspent. It was about 60-odd million, I think, in the last data that I saw in total for Scottish Government. So the question is, in terms of the total outturn for that total operating cost number, what numbers can you give us as to what happened. I'm assuming that'll be for 2021 or perhaps 2021-22.
Cameron on that.
So is this question specific to the DG Economy budget?
Education Directorate. I meant Education Directorate in terms of total operating costs.
So the skills and education portfolio net total operating cost outturn for 21-22 was 47 million against a budget of 43.6 million.
Right, so that's about 10% overshoot. And you don't have the data yet for 22-23 or 23-24?
No, we don't have that yet.
And you would expect those to be similarly overshot?
We can't say.
Right, certainly if that's the case for 21-22, your actual outturn for 21-22 is actually less than the budget you've got for 22-23. So I'm assuming there'll be an overspend roll forward as well. So I suppose the question is what work can be done if you've got a £49 million spend in there with possibly a 10% overshoot on it understand what efficiencies could be made in that budget line to free up more money for the front line.
Unfortunately, it's too early to say anything about 22-23 outturn, but I take your point.
Okay, so it'd be good to get some response back on that. Second question, the money then flows through to SFC, and SFC's got a budget of north of £2 billion for 23-24. So my question is how much of that money is used to fund SFC and how much of that money flows through to universities and colleges?
So I can answer that. So for 23-24, the SFC administration budget is £7.784 million, which is comprised of £7.634 resource and £0.15 million non-cash.
Million, something, okay. Okay, now thanks for that. And again, is there any work being done to look at if there's any potential savings in SFC administration
yes.
costs?
Yes.
Okay, thanks. And then the third part of that then is round about the Glasgow College Board, which is another layer in the hierarchy, the costs of that and what has been done to look at how much of that money can go to the front line.
So the latest figures for 21-22 have running costs of £675,000 for the Glasgow College Board. I think certainly Mr Dorris will be aware, and the committee members who were here previously will be aware that the government is considering options on the way forward in terms of governance of the Glasgow College region following the appraisals exercise that was done. And I'm aware of Mr Dorris's views on this and those of others. Any decision that's taken by myself will be subject to a 12-week public consultation. And I would hope we'd be in a position to take that decision and begin that process relatively soon.
Okay, thanks. So, yeah, just to conclude, if you're able to come back to the committee with some more detail on that Education Directorate spend, likely overspend, and what work's been done to figure out how to become more efficient with that £49 million-plus that's spent on civil service support.
We can do that once the figures are available.
Thank you.
And I've had Mr Dorris indicate a supplementary, I suspect, on the topic of Glasgow. Yes. Yeah.
Convener, I've obviously said for a number of years now, including in submissions, that the regional board should go. The £675,000 that you mentioned, would that money be retained by colleges in Glasgow should the board be abolished?
So, should the board be abolished, I think it would be reasonable to assume that there will be some residual spend, tapering off costs. But if such a decision were to be taken, it would be with a view to maximising the monies that were available to colleges.
So in Glasgow? Colleges in Glasgow, not colleges full stop?
To be clear... sorry, can you...
No, I'm just saying that's his last question.
Mr Dorris,
I understand what he's asking. He's asking if the £675,000
would be spent. Funds,
Mr Dorris, the decision has not been taken. When the decision is taken, I'll write to the committee in full, giving as much detail as I possibly can. You will appreciate at the moment no such decision has been taken.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Mr Day. Can I now move to some questions from Stephanie Callaghan, please? Thank you for your patience, Stephanie.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister. Being realistic and the inflation currently so high, it's very possible that we're going to find some of our colleges and universities facing serious financial difficulties. And what support will be available if that is the case, Minister?
Universities are in the fortunate position of holding reserves, which colleges are not. And that said, there are some universities are less well placed than others, and we're very much alive to that. In terms of the colleges, no colleges have indicated to us that they are in a perilous state as such. Were they to do so, then clearly we would engage with them on that. But I go back to what I said earlier. There is a substantial exercise underway to identify how we can better support the colleges with the existing budgets. One of the things I found in the 7 weeks that I'm in post is there is a very congested landscape in terms of who does what, how the monies flow across the entire skill sector. And I do firmly believe that that can be rationalised to good effect so that more of the monies are available for the front line, as was mentioned earlier on. And that is part of what we're looking at just now. We want to ensure that the maximum amount of monies are going to the front line to deliver for learners, and that's what we're committed to looking at.
So I suppose that kind of takes us back to you speaking earlier on about transitions funding actually being about making those changes. So I'd be interested in hearing a wee bit more detail around that. And are you also looking as well, for example, New Battle College, New Battle Abbey College, who had written into us, was having a look there, and there's some commercialisation stuff going on there. So they're doing heritage centres, weddings, etc. there as well. Obviously, that's something that's quite unique to them. But I'm wondering whether or not actually those commercial aspects are something that are being considered, and if that's something that you're exploring and working with universities and colleges on.
Well, I mean, other colleges will look to exploit the assets they've got. And some, I think, suspect now will be looking even harder at that. It's difficult for me to put detail to this when a lot of it is still under discussion. But I think everyone has ideas about how we could do things differently. And what I would commit to is our approach to those ideas will be to treat them on the basis of, well, why wouldn't we do that rather than why would we? So there's a positive response to ideas that are brought forward. As I say already, I'm seeing some things I think that we could be doing differently. The colleges will have their ideas as well, and that conversation is underway because I think there's opportunity there to address the kind of short-term financial pressures that we've got. And then there is a longer-term issue about getting the colleges on a much more sustainable footing.
Okay, thank you. Hopefully I'm not going to... Ruth Maguire, on that sort of theme of flexibility for colleges, could you maybe carry on with that?
Thank you. Thank you. Good morning, Minister. You'll be quite familiar with the committee's college regionalisation inquiry. And in that, we did call for more flexibility for colleges to manage their finances. You'll know they're restricted in their ability to generate additional income. They've got no ability to borrow or hold reserves. So we need to find a solution to operating within the current sort of financial envelope in the challenging times. When the previous minister visited the committee in November, he was pressed on the urgency of these matters and how quickly things could be dealt with. We've obviously got the SFC's review on sustainability. Can you speak a bit to that? And also, some of the... You said you met with college principals and reps last week. Did they come with specific ideas for what those flexibilities might look like and how they could assist them?
So, there were a number of flexibilities delivered for this year. I can go into some detail if you want, convener. They were specifically changes to guidance that will enable colleges to deliver optimal balance of full-time and part-time provision, the minimum credit targets being reduced by at least 10%, and still colleges that under-deliver on credit targets will be allowed to keep 20% of the funding for those credits, and the backlog and life cycle maintenance have been rolled into one funding allocation as opposed to providing separate allocations for each, and that allows the colleges to determine the most appropriate split between the two uses. Now, That's what's been done thus far. What I'm keen to explore is what we could do quite quickly with them, and then look at what we might be able to do beyond that. To be clear, the colleges, when we met them last week, didn't come with a list of asks, but late last year, they had brought forward a list of suggestions, some of which were acted upon, and some of which weren't at the time. We've asked them to come back to us with an updated list of suggestions, but sitting alongside that, I've tasked officials to look into some ideas that I have that I think might be useful to colleges. And I should be clear that that covers the resource area of the budget, but also capital, because I'm very much alive to the fact that the colleges have net zero targets to meet, and we're aware of, obviously we're all aware of the aging nature of some of the estate. So we're looking at what might be possible to do in that space. What I would say, Convener, is you appreciate I don't want to break confidences here, and we have to work this through with the colleges, but I'll be more than happy if I get the agreement at the colleges, once we've reached agreement around some of this, to write to the committee in detail about what it is we're doing.
Thank you. Yeah, I appreciate that. I appreciate that you will not be able to go into detail. I think what we're looking for is that assurance that the value of colleges will be, you know, we can demonstrate their value by acting promptly on this and giving them those flexibilities. So it's that assurance that I'm looking for.
Yes, but there are to be clear, we're looking at the flexibilities that we can provide without getting out of classification. So that we'll still be those rightful restrictions in place. But I do believe that there are things that we can do, and the colleges believe there are things that we can do jointly, which will assist them in their day-to-day operations. And I think we ought to be looking to do that as a matter of urgency. And if there's some things that will take a little bit longer, then we'll work on those with them.
Thank you. If I may, so the other area in line with that is, you'll recall we've spoken about the value of colleges and the work that they do for people who are furthest away from education, and that work takes a fair bit of investment in terms of staffing and money. I suppose I just want to highlight and get your agreement that in principle, because that work is more expensive and more it's more expensive, but it's very high value to our communities and to our learners. That's the type of area that can quite often get cut when budgets are tight. So again, that adds that urgency to ensure that we can get a bit of flexibility and sustainability for our colleges.
So I'm alive to that, and I'm also alive to the geographical challenges that some colleges face. Colleges in Mr. Doris's part of the world will not have the issues that Borders College, which I visited a few weeks ago, or UHI will have. And we have to be alive to the fact that it can't be a one-size-fits-all approach to this. We must recognise that certain areas will have a much more challenging environment, and so far as it is possible, take that into account.
Are you confident that our colleges will be able to continue to deliver these high-value but high-investment types of courses for our citizens who are needing that additional support?
Well, I recognise I'm certainly aware of one course that has closed in a locality because of lack of demand. So there will always be issues around that. But what I would say is my conversations with the colleges, they recognise the importance of that kind of delivery, and so do I.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ruth McGuire. Can I move to some questions now from Pam Duncan Clancy, please?
Thank you, Convener. And before I go on to the questions, I was going to ask just a very short supplementary from Ruth's point, if I may. We've already discussed briefly the issues around City of Glasgow College. When you do meet with the principal there to discuss some of these issues, will the Minister be discussing which courses may have to be cut as a result and doing an impact assessment on those?
A very brief... That was
well. Only Mr. Duncan Clancy, colleges are standalone institutions. The decisions that they make in that regard see them answerable to their boards. That's where that lies. But in a broader sense, I would hope and expect that when principals are making decisions of this nature, and they're difficult decisions, they are mindful of their responsibilities in the regard that Ruth Maguire indicated, but also in the preservation of key courses. Okay. So it's entirely up to them what they do, but those would be our expectations. And also that whatever actions they take are in line with the Fair Work agenda and in conjunction with the trade unions.
Thank you. That brings me nicely on to the points I was going to ask on. On the issue of boards, are you is it the government's intention to issue the good governance guidance anytime soon? And what's your view of having unions represented on boards?
Right. In terms of trade unions on the board, my instinct is yes, and I would anticipate that is where we will go.
Thank you. EIS have said that the EIS FELA have said that the stated cuts will make it much more difficult for college lecturers to get a pay rise commensurate with that of their colleagues elsewhere in the public sector. How would you respond to that, Minister?
I think that's a fair assessment. I think that is the reality, unfortunately. The colleges have been very clear about the implications of if they were to meet in full the request of EIS FELA for a pay settlement, what that would mean in job losses. And that's regrettable, but that is where we are. When I met EIS FELA last week, I encouraged them to try and find some common ground with the employers. I did the same with the employers. I hope and believe they are going to resume discussions quite shortly. Whether that leads to agreement, I hope it does, remains to be seen. But I'm afraid there's going to have to be a realism here about the situation as it exists. And you know, I would urge both sides to get together and find a way through this.
I don't think there's much more real than potentially 100 people in Glasgow losing their jobs or 1,500 people across the country, according to correspondence from the committee. It also appears to be, in my short time in this particular role, that there doesn't seem to be much direction to colleges or universities over what the government's expectations are. So can you set out when the government will indicate its expectations to the Scottish Funding Councils? And can you also set out what your expectations for colleges and unis are on Fair Work?
I think we're very clear about what's expected in terms of Fair Work. The colleges and universities know exactly what that is. And the Funding Council's dialogue with both is ongoing. So do you mean in a broad sense about guidance?
I mean quite specific, particularly in relation to City of Glasgow College.
Well, Ms. Duncan-Glancy, I think we go back to what we've talked about earlier. If the thrust of your point is that we should be putting more money into the college sector in order that that issue should be addressed, that's fine. But where does it come from? If that's the thrust of where you're coming from? Because we've been very clear, we're in a regrettable position financially. We can't put more money into the colleges. And I spoke to EIS FELA last week and I made this very clear. So if there's no more money available from government, and the colleges, if they are to fund that pay increase, and unions are perfectly entitled to look for a fair settlement with their employers, then unfortunately the only way that's going to be funded is through job losses and course cuts. I wish it wasn't so.
I think that's considerably regrettable, and I also think that, you know, the government have had 16 years to sort stuff like this out, and we're in the situation we're in. I don't think that will be an acceptable answer to people who might lose their jobs. My final question is short. How would you describe industrial relations in the sector, Minister?
In the college sector?
Both the higher education and the further education sector.
I think the industrial relations, as I've seen them as a member of this committee and then up close as a minister, are not at all good. There have been disputes in 8 of the last 9 years. And, you know, having spoken to both sides of this, I think we need to find some way of addressing that. Something the committee had a view on previously, and I share that view. In terms of the universities, obviously the universities are a slightly different setup in that it is a UK-wide industrial dispute. There is a pay offer there which has been rejected. Again, I've had conversations directly with University of Scotland in relation to specific issues that are happening in Scotland. I'd sought to encourage them to engage in a constructive way with UCU to try and get this resolved.
Thank you. Can we move to some questions now from Willie Rennie, please?
Welcome to your position, Minister. It's good to see you on that side of the fence. I do feel sorry for you in this position, because you have taken on a portfolio that is mired in confusion and delay, and it has been for some years. And I think what was quite characteristic of your contribution, and it's been an impressive contribution, I have to say, so far, is that you talked about taking quick actions. Well, that will be a dramatic change from recent years. I mean, if you look, there's no international strategy for the higher education sector. There's no final purpose and principles statement. It was promised in the spring. It's still not here. We've got no skills alignment, which was promised 6 years ago. We're still not in that position. And although you've talked about the flexibilities today for the college sector, we don't really have substantial change on that other than what you've mentioned. My concern is that on top of that, you've got a £46 million cut. How is that going to help all of that? How is that going to help the college sector and the university sector plan for the longer term, you know, something that you've acknowledged you'd like to happen?
So the international strategy has been worked on. It's coming. Purpose and principles, the statement, again, is pending. I've been keen to see a bit more meat on the bones on that than was perhaps there initially. So that's an element of the delay around that. But we have a number of things coming forward in a fairly concise period of time. We want to get the choreography right of those. I don't mean to manage it, but in order to give universities and colleges and the committee the opportunity to look at this in the round. And we obviously have the Withers Review coming as well. So what we're, the Cabinet Secretary and I, are doing currently is looking at the timings of all of this, as much detail as possible, that will allow the sectors, the two sectors, to respond, the committee to take a view, Parliament to take a view, wider stakeholders to take a view. And our intention is that on the back of all of that, to then have extensive consultation with people, and I mean face-to-face consultation with the colleges, universities, in order to get good feedback on where we need to take all of this. So it is about trying to take swift action, but it's also about planning for the longer term and to provide the stability right across all the sectors. But it's also across the skills and education landscape to have a coherent narrative, a clear direction. I think the committee, rightly in its work, had indicated that colleges needed a clear steer on what their purpose was. I totally agree with that. And that's what we're looking to do. They want it, we want to give them that. And it's a matter of where the colleges fit into the overall landscape. I happen to think it will be a key part of what we do going forward. But at the moment, the colleges are doing so much in so many different directions, and some colleges are operating differently. We need to make this much more coherent. We also need to declutter the landscape. It is far too complex just now. And I think we can do that in the short to medium term and make things a lot easier for people to progress. I recognise that answer's a bit waffly, but you know the thrust of what I'm saying. And what I would commit to is to keep the committee as up to date as possible with regular sort of information.
So all that's fine, but you not think it all might just be a little too late? I mean, they've already got flat cash. The £46 million you thought was coming isn't. They're going to be making decisions right now about what to do, what positions to keep, what people to, what positions to remove, what departments to focus on. All of that will be made without you having a single say on any of it. So is there not a danger that all of this will be too late? Sally Mapstone at St Andrews, she's talked about managed decline. Are you just not concerned that you just might be too late to the party and all the decisions will be taken and you'll have no say over it?
No, I'm not concerned about that. I recognise the timing's not good. The loss of the £46 million is not good. Although, for context, the loss of the £20 million from the university's budget is a very small proportion. I'm not downplaying that, but for context, and we'll come back to Sally Mapstone's points in a moment. I think, given the discussions that I've had with the colleges in particular, I think we can do enough in the short term to stabilise the situation to allow us to then kick on what we need to and want to do, what they want to do. In the context of universities, you know, Sally Marston, we have a great deal of respect for, just talked about managed decline in that sector. But the facts don't bear that out. If you look at the performance of the universities, and I could go through those if you wish, this is a sector that, despite the challenges, is vibrant. There's a fantastic enthusiasm about it. And yes, the reduction in the loss of the additional funding was a blow. I think in the context of universities, I think their concern was more about what they felt the message was behind that rather than the hard cash. It was that they felt that we had somehow deprioritised universities. Nothing could be further from the truth. But I take that message on board. And that's why we were having a lot of discussions with universities about how we can deal with this.
But, I mean, you've heard me talk about this before. Mm. The research performance has dropped from 15% of the UK Research Council funded to 12.5%. We were brilliant at this before. Brilliant. And we were still good, but it's going down. That's surely an indication of a managed decline. And if you reinforce that with a massive cut in their budget, flat cash as well, it's not really an indication that you're fully committed to universities, which are a major generator of economic performance, are they not?
They are indeed a major generator. But I go back to what I've said on a number of occasions, Mr. Rennie. If you want more money for universities, it has to come from somewhere else. That's just the fact. That's where we are. But I would certainly hope, and I've been speaking to individual university principals in recent days, I think there is an understanding that we do value our universities. I hosted an event 2 weeks ago with the German Education Secretary and a number of our universities. You know, I think that alone sends the message about the value we place in the role our universities are going to have going forward. I get the contradiction that you're alluding to between the financial side of it and that. But I absolutely give you the assurance that our universities, like our colleges, are going to be front and centre in what we're doing.
Are you going to do Erasmus replacement?
So, the Erasmus situation...
Mr Rennie, I'm going to move on from that because I'm really conscious of the time. I'm not going to ask the Minister to respond. I'm going to come to Stephanie Callaghan, please. I'm not letting him sneak in.
Thank you, Convener. Just very, very briefly, Minister, the purpose and principle statement we agreed at this committee previously was really critical and really central. And I understand there's loads of complexities around there and loads of things fitting together. But specifically, what are the likely timescales around that being published?
Can I give a specific date? No, I can't. But is it relatively imminent? Yes.
Thank you. I thought we were going to get another answer there.
Sorry,
we were just clearing your throat. thank you. Ross Greer, can we move to some questions from yourself now, please?
Thank you, Convener. Just first of all, Minister, following up on the issues around City of Glasgow College, so like colleagues I've met with the union representatives there, they believe at the same time as these compulsory redundancies are taking place that new management positions are being created at the college. Would it concern you to see new, what will be well-paid senior management positions come into being at the same time as lower-paid support and frontline teaching and lecturing staff lose their jobs?
If that were to be the case, it would be a matter of concern.
Thank you. And the principal of City of Glasgow College earns a salary far in excess of the First Minister.
Mr Greer, this is going off piste of what we were expecting, and I'm very conscious of the time, and I've got other members coming in. Can you perhaps stick to the scope of the range?
I'll stick to you. I will write to you about the outrageous salary of City of Glasgow College.
Mr Greer,
later,
please.
Minister. Students at St Andrews and Stirling Universities are facing 8% and 9% hikes in their university accommodation rent. This is at the same time as St Andrews University's reserves have increased by £4 million, from about £376 million to £380 million. Is it justified for universities to raise the cost of rent in their accommodation at the same time as they're banking money?
So, to answer the question as in much detail as I can, Convener, of course, an accommodation charge increase of that size is concerning. I guess what St Andrews University would say in the context of that is that they are also at the same time providing £24 million in bursaries for poorer students. So they would no doubt rebut your point in that regard. But yes, you're right. I'm aware of the situation at those two universities, and I have actually raised that informally with them and will be raising it formally, because I want to understand, while it's a matter for them, how those charges can be justified. In the context of reserves, it's very easy to look at reserves like underspends and say, well, wow, that's a lot of money. If you've got that money, it's a rainy day, why is it not being spent? But we also need to recognise that it would be reasonable to assume that institutions would retain reserves equivalent to 3 to 6 months of their expenditure. And I certainly recognise that. So we just need to be a little bit careful about viewing reserves in that regard, especially when they may not be cash reserves that can be readily drawn down. So there's a balance to be struck here in how we view these things. But I do take your point about the accommodation charges. And I think I've had correspondence from yourself and one of your colleagues on the issue, and I'll respond to it.
From Mark Ruskell, yeah. And thank you for that, Minister. On that wider point around reserves, though, and I agree with you, universities should maintain sufficient operating costs as reserves. Not all reserves are cash reserves. But Edinburgh University's reserves have gone up by £36 million to what's now £2.5 billion, which is far in excess of 6 months' operating costs at that university. Now, you're right, not all of that is cash. A very significant proportion of it is. Has the government done any analysis, and does the government have any policy position on the reserves held by Scottish universities? Because there's an issue here for the public finances. We give a very large amount of money to our universities each year, quite rightly, but some universities are using that to maintain, to be a going concern. Other universities are banking almost £40 million a year and now have a reserve that's about four times what the Scottish Government can legally hold in its reserve at any given time.
Of course, one would be concerned if reserves were being banked just for the purpose of having them. But I suspect that some of the universities that you would talk about are investing incredibly heavily in a variety of ways. So whilst I would be concerned about excessive reserves, of course, I think we need to take a very calm look at this situation and look at what these universities are actually delivering at the same time.
Thank you. Can we move now to questions from Stephen Kerr, please?
Calm and considered reflection. I'm all for that. And that's what Sir Peter Matheson called for last week when he raised the issue that he termed as a brain and cash drain south of the border. Now, we were both on the same radio programme, so I listened very closely to what you had to say on Drive Time on BBC Radio Scotland. Why is the government not engaging openly and in a calm and considered way with what was a very reasonable and reasoned approach from Sir Peter on the issue of revenue that currently the Scottish universities aren't getting that they could get, which is ending up south of the border?
Well, I'm glad to hear you're going to follow Sir Peter's lead and take that calm and rational approach, Mr. Kerr.
Well, you can tell in the tone of my voice.
I was shocked. I actually spoke to Sir Peter last night. We talked about this in detail. He was trying to make a helpful contribution to the debate, or to a debate. I understand entirely where he's coming from, but his central premise is actually wrong. If you look at the numbers of Scottish domiciled students who are going to university in England, it has come down. So there is not an increase, it has come down. I'll write to you with a figure on that. So anecdotally, I don't doubt he's aware of certain cases. So I think the central premise for that argument that he advanced is flawed. Nevertheless, of course, people will hold different views on tuition fees. Your party holds different views to mine. We fundamentally believe that the ability to learn is what should determine your opportunity to go to university, as opposed to the ability to pay for it. And what also I think has been lost a little bit in the discussion that followed this is it's not simply about saying that certain students would have to pay tuition fees, as Sir Peter argued, for those of wealthier families. Because they'd also have loan repayments as well. So it's substantial sums of money. And, you know, you're entitled to hold a view. Mr Rennie's party will have a view. Sorry to intrude on your grief about tuition fees. But we hold to a view, and I'm happy to defend that. But what I'm also happy to do is to talk to people like Sir Peter, who's a deeply respected individual. And, you know, as I say, we discussed this last night. I won't share what we discussed, but it was a very constructive discussion.
The Conservative position on this is, as you well know, not to have it mischaracterised, is that we also support paid tuition fees. Mm-hmm. But we understand that there are issues that arise with paid tuition. And when someone like Sir Peter, who's widely respected, not just in Scotland or the United Kingdom, throughout the world, when he raises issues around other ways that Scottish students might be able to get places in university, we think it's worth having that calm and considered debate, and I'm glad you did. But the First Minister's response, I don't think he'd read the article, and he immediately shut down the argument, because none of us are saying that there shouldn't be paid tuition. Well, what we're saying is, let's look at other ways that we can expand revenue streams for Scottish universities. If that involves Scottish families, and I'm not saying it should, but if it did involve Scottish families paying tuition fees for their sons and daughters go to Scottish universities, that can only be a good thing, surely.
I don't think the First Minister shot it down in the way that you put it. He was just clear that the position of this government is that this is, if you like, a red line issue for us. Sir Peter is perfectly entitled to express his view. And unfortunately, as you know, he was very clear, he wanted a canned discussion. It was a very limited approach, and in some cases it was portrayed as being he wanted to reintroduce tuition fees, which is not where he was coming from at all.
No.
But that doesn't mean that we agree with him, because we don't.
So, I mean,
final quick question.
I just think, in the context of what we've been discussing, the colleges have got a lot of airtime in the committee today, and quite rightly too. But the universities also, I mean, in their submission to us, just let's put this, all this discussion into context. They're saying that the university teaching funding has already been cut by the Scottish Government by 27% in real terms between 14-15 and 22-23. And then they're talking about, as Willie Rennie highlighted, their main research grant cut by 31% in the same period. We can't afford to allow Scotland's universities to languish. We cannot afford a managed decline. And Minister, I think you agree with that. Can you affirm here and now that on your term of office as the Minister for Further and Higher Education, that there will be no further decline in the funding of these institutions?
I want to go back to the central premise of your point. You were talking there about a figure about the decline in funding for university students. That figure is arrived at by the universities using a methodology which is at odds with the one that's only used by the Scottish Government, but your colleagues down south. So I would challenge the figure that's been quoted. Do I recognise the general point they make? Yes, I do. But it's not on a scale, if you use the same methodology that's used by the UK Government and ourselves, that this has been portrayed. And I can't sit here and tell you that that the picture will suddenly become rosier, the financial picture. I can't do that. What I will tell you, and as I've said today, we will work very closely with the universities and the colleges to do everything we can to improve sustainability in both areas. And that's what we'll be doing.
Thank you. And on that note, we can end that session. I'd like to thank you both for your time this morning. The public part of our meeting has now concluded, and we will consider our final two agenda items in private. Thank you.